Sponsored by Paradox.
Greetings and howdy ho, fellow sentient organisms. The old masters used to say the way to tranquility is through the door. Open the door and you'll find what you seek. Stellaris is rated E10+ for kids. Prepare to leave behind the transgressions of violence of our own corrupted world and embark upon the creation of a new utopian society that values helping and compromise, concern, truth, and equality. Take my hand. Whoever you are, welcome. My first species, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, were rough, rakish men, flawed and coarse. No, instead, we would create a new species. So many options to choose from. So in my embarkment, I selected the most lovable, adorable species. Just look at how cute it is. Guided only by friendship and love, the pilgrims of peace we would be. At all times seeking to come together and compromise our differences.
That's because we were too weak.
We began on a wet planet. Peace rock. Pacifist xenophile. Pacifist spiritual xenophiles. Caring only for the environment and others. A democratic people, so we would never get anything done.
What was deemed ultimately as a theocratic republic.
Workers of the galaxy, unite!
When it came time to choose an advisor voice, I think that the answer is quite obvious what I picked.
Those who need will receive. Those who make will make wonders.
The tranquil, serene, peaceful, quiet
lizardmen symbology, iconography.
We chose a heart for love and a circle which has neither beginning nor end. Together, a loving circle of life. Naturally, it provided for the plants, which would obviously be our ships that we would ride around in.
Hinkle Dinkle Swimmington was president of peace.
Namaste. So began our journey.
We recount the story of the Lizardmen. All civilization begins with science. The peaceful Lizardmen began on their home world, Peace Rock. Surrounding the star, Enlightenment, get it? Because it's a source of light. And they're also very peaceful, so it made sense. We start off in our own cluster of stars, three of them a trinary system, in the midst of a much larger galaxy, in the midst of a much larger universe. With hyperlane travel going for us, we sent out our science ships to the edge of the galaxy, shaped like plants, all of them, but completely harmless, with no weapons, no armaments, only love. For many of the worlds in our own star system were not habitable, and we'd need to travel to other star systems to scan and probe the other planets nearby. Most of them were just shit, but we had quite a lot of stardust to search through. There's our empire, symbolized by the little heart. We're learning as we go. Every planet has a governor. Pretty much every single thing in this game has some lizard in charge of it, so if there's a ship, there's a lizard to be found there. A lizard captain, in fact, or a lizard governor, in the case of a state. A nabob of sorts, taking good care and stewardship of the planets. Almost immediately, we discovered humble alien life. Dwarf men. Chunky, stubby dwarf men. They're to be found in the Adlamon system. The world required a lot of scanning, but news was abuzz on the lizard men radios and televisions. Answers were sought. Controversy was had. Doo-doo was flung. So we selected a planet to settle, but without much else to do, we turned inward. Adopting a tradition of harmony. Yes, harmony. That's right. Life could thrive, both on our own home planet and elsewhere in the universe. And thrive we would do. Our only aspiration, like that of the Tau, was the greater good. And what could be gooder than great? Nothing, obviously. So Adlamon was the first sector settled. But how does it actually feel to play Stellaris? Years of intergalactic interloping can only be demonstrated by invoking a series of images, all being beamed into your brains, wherein we simulated the proliferation of the Lizardmen species throughout the nearby star sectors. Never mind what all of the icons mean. There are far too many of them and they're too complex for you to ever understand with your smooth brain. Just know that you're in good hands with the Lizardmen. So we began to research unfathomably advanced technologies. One can only stare into the vast, endless void of space, getting blue-balled year after year by ancient alien artifact after ancient alien corpse,
never to find any sign of a living intelligent species before society begins to unravel and lose faith in its government collapsing. That is, until we discovered the ancient, violent mining robots. Sinister orange android spaceships that ate away at minerals and metal in the universe. For whom were they mining? Were we alone in a universe of hatred? Other species started prank calling us, claiming that they were our doom. As it turned out, the miners were actually friendly, and they wouldn't do anything to us. But Malays still ran amok. News of the evil robots spread home, stirring controversy. Society fractured out into factions, led by various self-proclaimed nabobs among the Lizardmen. There was the Church of Pious Traditionalists, not actually a church but a political party with the objective of keeping everything the same. The Xeno-Compassion Institute, who believed almost exactly the same things as the first party but unfortunately split the vote on our 10-year election cycle. One can only surmise how potentially confused voters would be at such a baffling turn of events, having seen two political candidates with completely identical looks and nearly identical platforms upon which they ran their campaigns. Therefore, I conjecture that this was a fallacy, a conspiracy financed and passed by the third party. This made way for the Progress Promotion Network, an underground cartel of lizards who had the audacity to disgrace and subvert our society of transcendent communist love with one of freedom and capitalism instead. The complexification of lizardman society began. So society expanded, and we intermingled with other star systems. One time we received a radio transmission from an unknown entity that involved a lot of intimidating howling. The howling died down. Then it rose back up once again, louder and still more intimidating than the first raucous transmission. While it might seem that the emergence of a common threat would cause the unification of society around a common enemy, it also functioned as a distraction that drained from our resources and allowed opportunities for manifold antagonistic cadres to advance their agendas and subvert the de facto order. As it turned out, the intimidating howling overheard on the intercoms was actually just a feature of this alien race's linguistic peculiarities. Their bombastic volume signaled their intrepid love of unknown people throughout the cosmos, for they too believed in non-violent cooperation toward a common goal of unity. It still didn't explain the species that had threatened to be our impending doom later on over the intercom, but at the very least, we now had rock friends upon whom we could safely rely in a pinch. We rushed at once to improve relations with these men, literal hunks of minerals. By our very adorable nature, they already felt protective over us, but still we summoned the most courteous of the lizard, Fira Naseter, to facilitate a dialogue advocating even closer rock-lizard species interconnectedness. Everything changed when the Fire Nation attacked. Just kidding. It wasn't actually the Fire Nation, but rather the nation of double-chin people who aspired to ever-complexifying technological breakthrough. In a species-wide moment of introspection, with the galaxy having been mapped, we turned inward toward ourselves and established universal basic income for all, a highly controversial decision that ultimately led toward more utils of happiness being pooped out onto our entire population. Can you imagine the intensity of our elation? But money doesn't grow on trees, as they say. With technological breakthroughs occurring at an ever-rapidifying rate, we were flummoxed at the world of opportunity. And with the widespread focus on meditation and harmony rather than jobs and infrastructure, we were led to an ever-harrowing rise in unemployment, undoing all of the happiness that we had just created in our society. In a tradition of solidarity, we negotiated an open-door policy with the Rockmen, whereby rocks should be able to enter into lizard lands, and lizards into the lands of the rock. It was decided that lizards should leave on a great crusade for work and employment, having outgrown the humble terra of Peace Rock. We cast our eye to further horizons in the vast mysteries of space toward the venerable rock, whom we sought as masters of employment. And although we disagreed with their stance on the decree of government, it remained cordial. This arrived at a crucial moment during Lizard Man society, at which we made first contact with the Savanti-E Enterprises, ruthless capitalists. An entire species of people dedicated to ruthlessly undercutting in pursuit of a greater bottom line. Unprincipled heathens. Their faction was the antithesis of everything we esteemed in living a tranquil, peaceful life free from suffering. How would we show them the way of light and guide them to a womb of serenity? With no time to waste, we sent out Firadna Setter, humblest and most cordial of emissaries, to improve relations with them and perhaps guide them to arrive at a higher stance at the understanding of tranquility in which they could partake, to join us in our feast of love. We do not purport to be pacifists like Duroc, but we truly believe that anyone can be our brothers and sisters, even if that means giving them all of your land and money until their consciences lead them to the epiphany that money and power are lies, land ownership is wrong and bad, and the only true reward in this life is personal transformation, self-actualization. I rerouted all of the resources of civilization toward making Savanti enterprises like us as much as possible so that they could know the full power of peace in motion. All of the lizard ambassadors simultaneously in the employ of complimenting Savanti enterprises for any possible attractive quality about them that would make them more receptive to our advances of love. While I would like to tell you that after 1 year, we convinced Savanti Enterprises to become peace-loving, selfless mammals. Unfortunately, this was the time that the pacifist Roc Nation decided to be not pacifists, threatening to declare war on us if we refused to be vassalized. Vaseline is no joke. Having imposed such a harsh self-rule of absolute non-violence, we had to agree to the Roc's demands, becoming a smaller nation within a cluster of stars run by lying conmen who posed as peacekeepers. It was the only way to fundamentally remain within the harsh confines of our moral boundaries. We would simply suggest that the Roc should let us go over time, along with all of the other nations they might ostensibly, peacefully threaten to go to war with. After this, we joined a galactic senate that opposed piracy, which led to yet another moral dilemma. Should we support the Senate's agreements to kill pirates? Because pirates try to kill people and take their things? Unfortunately, pirates are people too. Thus, by supporting, we were directly advocating killing. Pirates or not, we defaulted to agreeing so as not to cause more conflict. At this time, the bureaucracy was beginning to become overwhelming. I decided to give away my entire empire to the Roc because they wanted it. We may not necessarily have an empire anymore, but we have the moral high ground, especially Firadna Setter. So, is Stellaris for everyone? I rate the pacifist experience as Stellaris on hard, nay, impossible mode, only for masochists. So be it. Stellaris is for young masochists. Paradox knows gamers. A major thanks to Paradox for sponsoring this video. You can check out the new aquatics pack to make your own peace-loving fish. As always, a major thanks to my generous patrons. I'm Ambiguous Amphibian. Until next time.